All right, so I created a brand new account. It's very barren, but what I see is this is the name of my business. We've got various tabs over here. I'll cover what these different tabs and windows mean. But perhaps I think what I want to do first, similar to when I talked about Facebook, we jumped into the settings of Facebook early on. And I think it's useful to always review the settings of all of these networks, because oftentimes the basic settings might not be exactly what you expected. And I think on Pinterest it's one of the worst ones, unless they've changed it, which is that you're going to get so many emails about so much activity happening on Pinterest. So the way to fix that is the settings. Let's look at our settings here. So I've logged into Pinterest. On the top right corner, I've got a little icon over here on mine. It's just a generic person here. I haven't put my logo or anything like that yet. But when I click on that icon, this is my profile or settings. Let's go over to settings on the top right corner icon. So I won't go through every setting like on Facebook. A lot of them are self-explanatory. But I want to make you aware of this screen right away. Here's where you can change your email, the language of Pinterest. When you created an account, it asked you for a business type. And maybe I want to change that. I put brand and maybe, oops, I meant local business. So you're able to change all of the features or all of the settings that you made for your account the first time. The name of your business. Okay, here's a couple of items. Search privacy. Hide your profile from search engines. You probably do not want that one turned on. That is going to hide you from the search engines. That's pretty bad. People use Google and Bing and Yahoo to find stuff. And if you hide yourself from the search engines, they might not find you. There's very small edge cases of why you might want to do that. It doesn't really apply to most of us, so I would not recommend turning on privacy there. You don't want to be hidden from potential customers. There's a couple of options here that are turned on for personalization. Use sites you visit to improve which recommendation and ads you see. Use information from our partners to improve which recommended ads you see. Okay, well, nowadays, on most of these networks, you're going to see ads. Not the ones that you create, the ones other people created. So I'm gonna see ads for a cool new purse or a cool new barbecue grill. Well, I'm gonna see ads on all of these networks. There's really no way to say, I don't wanna see any ads. All of the networks rely on ads because, again, from the other side of it, I'm a business. I want to put ads. I want to do well from these networks. So I don't want to lose ads, my ads, therefore you cannot lose ads on your own account. However, these say right here, we're going to show you ads, and even if you turn these off, this does not mean you're not going to see ads. This just means what kind of ads. This says, based on websites that I visit, show me ads I might be interested in. So if I often visit websites about technology, I'm going to see ads on Pinterest about technology. If I turn that off, it's just going to show me generic ads about things I won't care about, and they'll annoy me even more. So there's no right or wrong answer to select on these. You're not selecting, don't show me ads. You cannot opt out of that. But you can at least choose to see relevant ads or not. So whatever you want to pick for these is fine. Probably leave them on, because then you will see relevant ads.
And that's just your, as you search Pinterest, or is it tracking all your web traffic?
All your web traffic.
Okay.
Use sites, websites you visit to improve. Yep, so it's even outside. So they're gonna put a cookie on your computer that tracks your internet traffic. And yes, that sounds terrible, and I guess it is, and most people will care about that. So if you don't want that to happen, but again, you're not going to opt out of ads. You're just going to say, don't track me as I visit websites to show me ads. Now, one reason you might have it on a reason to have relevant ads on, you will see ads about the content that matters to you, which could give you inspiration for your own ads. So here's the best case scenario. I am a bakery. I have a local business, Victor's Bakery, and I want to sell baked goods. So perhaps I'm browsing the internet on my leisure time and looking at recipe websites and looking at food websites and restaurant websites. If I leave it on, that Pinterest sees that, I will then eventually start seeing ads on Pinterest on that topic. Well, I'm then going to see ads about businesses, local businesses, restaurants, food-related companies. Seeing other people's ads could then give me inspiration. That photo looks great. I can take a photo like that. That ad is pretty fun and clever. I like how they worded it. I'm gonna borrow what they did, but make it my own way. I'm going to get inspired by something that I saw that resonated to me, spoke to me, and I'll do my version of it. You know, that's the best case scenario. Some inspiration, some ideas, because you're not going to get away from ads, but at least maybe show me ads that are relevant or interesting to my business niche to inspire me, which could give you inspiration for your own ads. Okay, other settings. Here's where you can say, okay, well, you've been tracking me for a little while. Let me clear what's been searched. There's deactivate the account. So if I created this account as a testing account just to learn how Pinterest works, at a certain point, then I can delete it. Just deactivate the account. The name of my business, picture, username, about, location. All of that's empty when you create a brand new account. And I've mentioned this at least 3 times before on the last month. What's the value of this? Remember I said step one of using any of these networks is you want to have your basic information filled in. So as usual, fill in the basic info about your business, your about page. Reason, these are areas to help improve your search engine optimization. So write sentences with keywords to help you get found. I've got a spot right there to write a biography about my business. I should take advantage of that to write a little paragraph, 2 or 3 sentences, about my business that mention the important keywords. San Diego, bakery, organic, gluten-free, whatever. Whatever the keywords are of my business that I think are going to help me get found. These can be changed at any point, of course. But also another reason why would a customer follow a barren account. I don't know what you're about. Your logo is not on the little picture box there. Your description doesn't explain what your business is. Why would I follow you? So that's part of the reason to also fill in those boxes. You need to do that on Pinterest, on Twitter, on Facebook, on all the networks. They've all got a little box for you to fill in. It's okay for you to use the same info on every network. Same graphic, same bio text, it's fine. You can do that on all the networks. There's a school of thought in social media marketing that makes sure it's exactly the same everywhere. So then for consistency, There's a school of thought completely opposite that says change each one a little bit per the network. If I'm trying to reach a young target audience in one network, maybe I'll use more slang and colloquialisms in the speech. And then another network is a little bit more professional, so maybe I'll write a little bit more professionally in that. Or you can change it a bit for each network. There's no wrong answer there. Obviously, most people, they want to come in to these classes and get a straight answer and do exactly what I tell you. But you should be seeing by now, if you've taken the previous classes, that this really, I can teach like the basic tools. I can teach you how to use a hammer, but then it's up to you to build a house because your particular needs are different than the person right next to you. I cannot teach exactly one answer to 25 people for everyone to succeed. So the point here, this way your message is consistent on all platforms, or if you change it, capitalize on each network's demographics. So if I know I'm going for a female-friendly audience, I might put in a biography that focuses on that. If I know I'm going for a tech-friendly audience, I put in information focused on that. Again, that's what I cannot exactly teach because everyone's got their own niche or their own demographic that they're going after. So business name, about you, about your business, what's your location, fill that in. And then, of course, your username. When I created Pinterest for the first time, it gave me an address of pinterest.com/victorsbakery0648. So I don't like that. I don't like those random numbers there. I don't like that that's my official Pinterest address. I want to have simply Victor's Bakery. The thing that's weird here, you won't see if this name is available until you click Save. So before you proceed with any of these other settings, if you want to change your username here, you want to click Save early. You want to click Save early on, and then it'll say it's taken. So that's weird that they don't have it programmed that it'll tell you right away that the name is taken. I'm not going to claim the real name right here. I don't want to take it from whoever already has it. And if you're doing this on a testing account, obviously I don't want to set this here correctly because it's just a testing account. But you want to claim your name here so that no one else does. Okay, more settings over here. Here's another thing about claim your website. Claim your website to unlock these handy features. Okay, so if you've got a website, you can basically connect it with your Pinterest account. It'll give you a few more features also, such as website analytics. So this is somewhat like the Facebook Pixel. This is now Pinterest can track data on your website about how effective your pins are. You get a little check mark that also says that this is that it's been verified, that this is the official account. This is similar to Facebook Pixel in that you have to write a little bit of code, or actually copy and paste a little bit of code. says enter your website above and claim it in a few simple steps, but really it is that you have to add a specific line of HTML code that it will give you onto your website. So if you're able to do this, I would, so that it further gives you data, but it does require some familiarity with writing some a little bit of code, copying and pasting a little bit of HTML code. Okay, here's the part that's annoying. Notifications. You can get notified in Pinterest via your email, or push notifications, which mean alerts on your phone. Each one of these then is editable to give you some features. On Pinterest, I would leave that setting as is, meaning that when I'm logged into the Pinterest website, up here on the corner, this little bell will show me some activity has happened. I do want that. I want to be aware of who has liked my pin, who has followed me, and etc. So I would leave turn on everything on Pinterest. You might want to think about then via the email, this is the one that says, whenever something happens on email, send me an email about it. That's the one that I think is way too much. I don't want to have my inbox full of emails that tell me, you got a new follower, you got a new like, etc. I want to only deal with that when I'm logged into Pinterest. Now, however they define just the good stuff, you know, that sounds fun, but what does that mean? Probably you want turn off email. There are a few required emails that they have to send. You can't get out of those. So whatever you'd like to pick here, probably turn them off, because you're going to see that activity still when you're logged into the website. This one then, this next group right here, this is for you to decide. I don't have a recommendation here. Get helpful emails for your business, like campaign updates, expert tips, and more. So here you'll get like their newsletter for businesses on how to succeed in Pinterest. I would say leave it on everything and then get a feel for what they're sending you, and then if you at a certain point you feel I'm getting too much, then you can change it. Like maybe the important stuff. So this will give you emails about how well your campaigns, your boosting has worked and such. Or you can turn it all off, but there's still some required things you'll get. You can pick what you want there. I would kind of recommend get everything. They're not going to be as many emails as having the top one turned on. Push notifications, well, that one's what happens then on your phone. On those, I would leave those to everything. Yes, send me all of these info. I have the Pinterest app on my phone. I want to get a little alert that says I got a new follower. That's me personally. If you already get too much stuff, messages from friends and family and such, well, I don't need any more. I'll just look at it when I'm actually in the Pinterest website. Here's a spot for you to turn it off. And again, maybe somewhere in the help file it tells you exactly what just the good stuff means. But I wish they would explain it better. Oh, this is interesting. This is new. There was this option of picked for you.
What about the on the computer? Does it push notifications on your computer?
Well, that's that you'll get a little pop-up when you're sitting at your computer that will also tell you stuff is happening on Pinterest.
I don't know, which way is actually on and which way is off? To the right is on or off?
To the right is on. To the left is off because it's blank. Okay. To the right is on. Yeah, that's not obvious either, but to the right is on. His home feed has a note. This setting is being retired. Instead, we've created a feed focused on stuff you follow. So there was an old option on Pinterest, you know, in the old days, 2 months ago. It would have this feature that would show you extra stuff. It would say, we think you will like these pins based on your usage of Pinterest. Apparently that was very unpopular or not useful, so Pinterest is removing it. This is again what I said. If you took this class before and you learned this stuff changes. So, okay, doesn't matter. Here you have, you can connect these different networks. This is not as useful as you think. This is basically, if I connect Facebook, this means that I can log into Pinterest with my Facebook login. That's not saying that automatically also post my pin from Pinterest into Facebook. That's not saying automatically post my pin to Google Plus when I post it on Pinterest, unfortunately. That just means another way to log into your account. So these are not really that useful. Don't worry about them. Security and apps. If you've logged into your account on various web browsers, you get a list of them here. And the point of this then is, well, I don't recognize this login. Is someone trying to hack me? Let me log them out. And if you connect any other websites or apps to your Pinterest account, they'll be listed here, so you can disconnect them. I'm going to click Save, and then all of those changes get saved. Oh yeah, the username. So again, it doesn't know to check until you save. That was the settings screen. Not too complex, especially compared to Facebook, but any questions on the settings screen? Go ahead and click on your icon on the top right corner, the little person, or if you've got a logo there, click on that, and then click on My Profile. So on your profile, you have a spot for you to add your logo and this background color or background image. That'll be filled in as you work with it. We've got then these little tabs here, overview, boards and pins. I'll make some quick notes here about what each of these are. On your profile page, menu bar, overview, boards, pins, followers, following, tries. So overview, your latest content, boards, your organization of your pins, and I'll go into these in detail in a moment. Pins, your content uploaded to Pinterest, followers, your customers paying attention to you, following, who you are paying attention to, and tries. This one's interesting. What you have tried. Again, I'll go to these in detail in a moment, but your business or personal account has these various little menu items. And this one of overview, if you're going to be active posting something brand new once a week on Pinterest, this is where you can see also what your content has been, kind of like chronologically, because Pinterest, a lot about what it is that you organize your content. One of its unique selling things is that you organize what you upload, when you upload something to Twitter, it just goes in one long chronological order, basically. When you post something into Facebook, it's all one long chronological order. I have to scroll and scroll and scroll back to find what I posted 2 weeks ago. My followers have to scroll back a while, 10 pages, to find what I posted, you know, 10 days ago. Pinterest also has that organization in that you can go back to existing content, but it also focuses on boards. So right here, boards, a big selling point, or USP of Pinterest. Does anyone know perhaps what USP stands for in terms of marketing? Unique selling proposition. What's the uniqueness of something? I'm a restaurant. There's another restaurant down the street. We're both pizza parlors. We both sell pizza. Well, what's unique about me? What's my USP? What's the unique selling proposition of my pizza parlor compared to the other one? These social networks have their own USP. I can post photos on Pinterest, and I can post photos on Facebook and LinkedIn and all the networks. So what's unique about Pinterest? One of their USPs is boards. So just to define this, unique selling proposition. One of the unique aspects of Pinterest is boards. We'll see how they work in a moment. But it's something to take advantage of because it is unique on this network compared to the others. The actual content that you upload, they're called pins. Could be pictures or video. Video is less common. Pictures are often square. Pro tip, long vertical pictures are, how do I say it, advanced? Yeah, we'll say advanced. When I show that, I'll go into more detail, but think about pictures. You often see maybe a vertical picture, a photo of something, or a landscape picture, horizontal. There's also square pictures. Now, Pinterest, if you've got long, tall, vertical pictures like this, these can be pretty effective. We'll see why when I show that, but just make a note of that. Long, tall, vertical pictures can often be pretty useful. Or we'll say more effective. Followers and following, we've talked about those on the different networks. It's the same thing, and then here is where you block followers. All of these networks, their basic premise is for it to be public, that everything that you do is going to be visible to everyone. And I want that for a business, yes. I want my photos and everything to be visible by everyone. For a person, I might want to put it as private to only allow certain people to see my content. But for a business, you want to keep it public. You can, however, block people. You can block, you know, those that are harassing or annoying or belligerent. You're okay to do that. You can block accounts from seeing your content. Following, you can you alert people when you follow them, but not when you unfollow. People always ask that. If I follow people, that is, if I unfollow people, will they know about it? No. They might realize it eventually when they look on their own followers' screen and don't see you there, but they don't get any notification that you've stopped paying attention to them. Yes.
Is there any point in following your self? In other words, using your personal account to follow your business account? Is there any, do you gain any knowledge from that?
Not really.
If you follow all of your own accounts?
Not really. You would just get an inflated or artificial follower count. It would show, oh, I've got 7 followers. People would see, I've got 7, that person has 7 followers, that business has 7 followers, but all 7 of them come from your own account. So it just shows people that you have some followers, but you probably don't have enough accounts to follow to really be meaningful. Maybe I'm following in 2 accounts. So there's really no value for you to follow your own accounts. I could sort of also say there's actually some liability in terms of, I've got Victor's Bakery, and Victor Campos is going to follow Victor's Bakery. Well, I didn't want people to know Victor Campos owns Victor's Bakery. People would be able to see who is following Victor's Bakery, and they're going to see my name. So then people could go and harass me on my personal account, or then they can post like, oh, look at this, the business owner is following their own account. So I don't think there's much value for yourself to follow yourself. Tries. This one's interesting. The literal thing about it is what you have tried. I'm going to see a recipe on Pinterest, and I can click a button saying, I've tried that. So the literal thing about it is, yeah, I've eaten that, I've tried that, I've cooked that, I've painted that, I've done that. Well, for you as the business, that kind of sounds really worthless. Like, why would it matter that my business tried something? But some of the value that I see to that is, again, inspiration. Useful for inspiration. You could see pins, even if you don't try it, no one's going to confirm with you. Did you really try that? Did that cake really turn out that well? No one's going to confirm any of that. You can click try. I tried it on anything. Yeah, I did a baked Alaska, no problem. No one's going to confirm that. But the point of that is perhaps useful for inspiration for you to create content. Maybe I will identify things that I have tried that I would like my followers to try. So I'm going to create a version myself to entice people to try it. Okay, let's do something tangible here. Let's go to boards. There's no boards, there's no pins, there's no content. I've said before, for any of these networks, you want to create some content. So for all networks, you want to create some content to show people. Let's see. Before you try to get followers, for all networks, you want to create some content to show why it would be good for them to follow you. Does anyone recall from a previous week what I recommended as some basic amount of content before you try to get followers? Yeah, just 1 to 3. So basic is 1 to 3 original posts. However, for Pinterest, also create boards. From here also 1 to 3, which then determine how many pins. So if I'm saying, like, on Twitter, 1 to 3 tweets, Facebook, 1 to 3 posts, Instagram, 1 to 3 posts, The crinkle here is there's also what are known as boards, which are where you organize your pins. I'm going to upload a photo of a cake, and Pinterest has you, forces you, you have to put a pin into a board. You have to organize it somewhere. So if I decide I'm going to create three boards, and I'll show that in a moment, if I'm going to create three boards, well, I'm going to have like sort of like three empty containers. So in each of those containers, I need at least one pin. So what the boards are like this. Let's take a look right here. Look at this. This is an ancient Pinterest right here. What is this right here? A bulletin board. A pin board. I'm going to pin something to this board. That's Pinterest. Ancient Pinterest. Because Pinterest is about pinning stuff for people to see. When people come into this room, they have access to look at the stuff here about what classes about graphic design and classes about technology and whatever. So you're not, in theory, depending on the room that you go to, there's going to be different pins on the pin board. It's Pinterest. I'm going to have an account all about a certain topic. You want to follow my account to see those pins. We only have one in this room, but other rooms have more than one. Let's say I had a pin board on that wall and a pin board on that wall. And on this one, I want to show information when people walk in right away about like no food and beverages, emergency plan, and so forth. And on the back, I've got a pin board all about the latest, our homework, let's say. So two different pin boards with different topics, different purposes. Go look at that one when you want to find basic college information. Go to that one when you want to find out information about this class. That's the idea for boards in Pinterest. You organize pins on a certain topic into a board. So on the screen that we're looking at right now on Pinterest right here, it says, okay, create a board. Here we'll have tips on creating boards. Let's go here, click create a board. This is something that has also been changing throughout the years that I teach this. It used to be that when you created a board, you also had extra options. Those extra options now are hidden in another screen, and I will show you those extra options because there, that will definitely be helpful to you for you to know when your competition doesn't know this. They used to have it just obviously right here, now it's elsewhere. So here's the first part. What's the name of your board? And they're giving you suggestions. Places to go, recipes to make. Again, an active voice, not a passive one. It's not, the board is simply not called recipes. It's called recipes to make. It's something active. Again, the culture, the demographics of Pinterest are more about activity, about what I could try or buy or do, rather than what I can look at passively. So the first tip here is create boards with an active voice. So bad is recipes. Good is recipes to try. Gooder is kids, I'll say healthy kids recipes to try together.
And is that a searchable title?
Yes, exactly. It's searchable, all those keywords. People are gonna search in Pinterest for these sorts of things. I've got that, those keywords that people can latch onto to hopefully get me more views. Bad, good, best. So this again depends on your own particular needs of your own business. I cannot teach an answer to everyone. During the breaks, of course, all the time, you are welcome to pick my brain, and maybe we'll figure out your particular terminology for your particular business. So here's our first step here. So I'm Victor's Bakery. I'm just gonna take the same one right here. Now again, I'm just trying to sell cookies and birthday cakes and all of that, but I still have to create content for people to at least see. People are not always gonna be searching for birthday cake. I'm trying to buy a birthday cake. People won't think that they need you until they remember that they need you. So if you stay on their minds, if they follow you because you're constantly sharing great photos of cookies and cakes, and you're constantly sharing, you know, like a free little quick recipe or whatever, they might then suddenly think, well, I need a birthday cake. It seems that Victor's Bakery knows what they're doing. Let me give them a call. Let me click their website link. So I'm going to create a board here. Now the grammar of it. Are the kids healthy or are the recipes healthy? Any grammarians in the class? Healthy recipes for kids to try together. Whatever. You know, that's something to think about grammar-wise. Secret board. This is to create a private board that no one would see it unless they have the link to it. Again, most of the time you don't want to have these things private. I would say for most businesses you want most of this to be as public as possible for people to find you, see your pins, follow you, buy your stuff. And there are use case scenarios, of course, that people want to have something private so that it's exclusive, but you can decide that on your own. I'll click Create. We then have more to look at here, but let me show you first the secret thing that will help you more, help you a little bit more to get followers. And get found. There's a little pencil here to edit the board. Unfortunately, Pinterest is kind of weird in this regard, in that usually when you hover your mouse over something, you might get a little pop-up, little info. Now, if I hadn't told you that that was a pencil, would you have realized that was a pencil? And if it's a pencil, well, what does that mean? Well, that's to edit your board. Maybe that doesn't make sense. Maybe I want to write something. So what's weird is, okay, what's this icon right here? There's no pop-up to tell me what it is, so you tell me, what do you think that icon is? I know, I said what is that icon, not what does it do? You're jumping ahead. Very good. You're seeing share. But no, what is it? Doesn't it look like one of those outboxes in like an office? This is what's gonna go out. This is what's gonna come in. So right here, Pinterest is kind of weird in that they're using some icons that are not that common. And also there's no little pop-up to tell me what is that. Now, nothing's gonna break if you click it to find out what it is. And then I see, okay, share. I'm gonna send this over to Twitter or send it to Facebook or Messenger or I guess that's WhatsApp, or email it to someone and whatever. But that's what that is. It's share. It's spread it to more people. But I might not have been able to tell what that was just by its icon. Here's another case. What is this icon here? What? Compass. Are you sure it's not the evil eye of a snake looking at you? It's a compass, and it's something called Explore, which we will explore what Explore means later. But these icons, some of them just don't quite make sense until you click. Okay, what is this one right here?
Messages.
Messages is the concept of it, but what it is a little speech bubble of people speaking, I guess. Or is it Morse code? And then the bell and the person. So, yeah, I don't know why Pinterest doesn't give you a little pop-up about what is this. You have to click on it to actually see what it is. Messages. And then the three dots right here. More options. Okay, what I was about to do was click on the pencil. This takes you back to edit your board. And there's this spot where I can go back to properly spell what I misspelled. Even better is a description. This used to be here when you first created the board. In the old days, you know, a long time ago, 4 months ago. Now, it looks like they've changed it to this extra step that not everyone is going to know about or remember to do. You now know about it. You should then be taking advantage of this because your competitor might not know or be doing this. Here's another spot for you to write another paragraph full of sentences and keywords for you to be found. This is visible to people, but not a lot of businesses know to add this because it's hidden. So something that I might write here, well, actually, let me put it in the notes, then more tips here. After creating a board, click the pencil to edit it, then fill in at least the description. This is for more SEO juice. That's the industry term. More possibility of being found. So same sort of thing. Good, bad, better. Is that something short is not that good because you have a lot of space to write stuff. Anything better is a complete sentence, and then the best is, you know, two or three sentences. I don't think there's a limit to how much you can write here, so you can take advantage of, so let me write a lot. Okay, here, 500 characters. You can write up to 100 characters. That's a lot. So you've got 500 characters to fill in a lot of useful information. So things that I would do here are, for example, easy to make recipes for you and your kids to enjoy. We only bake, I can say, we at Victor's Bakery. We at Victor's Bakery only use organic ingredients. And bake with healthy choices, healthy options. So I've got the keyword of the name of my business, I've got the keyword of organic ingredients, healthy, kids, recipe, etc. Here's another thing that used to be obvious when you created the board, and now it's hidden. Category. What kind of board is this? This is for you to further get organized and be findable on Pinterest. So now you have to do this extra step here, and I found it. Food and drinks. People that are interested in searching for the category in food and drink could then find my board, my pins. When you don't put anything by default, it's a little bit harder to get found. And notice again, when this, just a few months ago, when this was, when they had this previously, that would be automatically there for you to do when you created your board. I don't know why they removed it. I think it's detrimental to people that they removed it, but maybe not. Maybe it is helpful for us because then when you know about it, you get ahead of the competition. Here's where you can turn on or off the secret board. And here's where you can add collaborators. So collaborators. Collaborators are those you approve to be able to add to your board. You created the board, and by default, only you can add something to it. But if you approve other people as collaborators, other people can also add to the board. The purpose of this is I'm running the Victor's Bakery Pinterest account. It's my business. I'm running it. But I also want some of my employees on their downtime, perhaps have them also post a great photo of the product. Purpose: to have other people in your business also contribute to the board. Having them help you out to add content as well. These last items are here, pretty self-explanatory. I'm going to delete this. I have to double check if they've changed this or not, but I believe that if you delete a board and it has three pins in it, I believe those pins are also deleted, unless you've got a pin in another board. So you can have one pin in multiple boards. So if I delete this board, but a pin existed on this and another one, it should be still in your account. But if you have a pin that's in one board and you delete that board, I believe that deletes the pin off of your account. I have to confirm that. Yes?
Did you say what the secret was
on? Yeah, the secret was that it's a private board that no one can view unless they have the link to it. A pin can be in more than one board when you delete a board, the pins also delete, unless it's also in another board. And I have to confirm that, so I'll put a little asterisk right there. So everything's got to be in a board. That's, again, one of the unique things about Pinterest. Everything's got to be in a board. Therefore, if you delete a board, you delete the stuff inside of it. We have archive, which is not as harsh as delete. Archive is going to sort of like unpublish it. No one can see it. No one can access it except you. And you can bring it back in case you need to. Merge is that I want to merge the content of this board with another board. Maybe I created one for kids' recipes and then one for, you know, one for holiday recipes. And I find that, well, they should just be the same thing. I can merge those boards together and all the content goes into one board. When you make any of those changes, you can save. It takes you back to the board. There's my description, which then people can see and people can search for. I can further organize a board into sections. So just more organization within the board once they get really big. I'm going to click on my icon right here for my account, or you can click on your icon on the top right and go to profile. I want to go back to my main profile. And now when I look at boards, I've got a brand new board. So I said about 1 to 3 boards. And then 1 to 3 pins. But here's further the caveat. You're going to see a little preview of what's in a board. These icons will change here to show you little thumbnails of what that board has. There's a slot here for 6 preview graphics. In my opinion, if I create 7 boards, but I put 1 thing in each board, it's gonna look like incomplete, because 1 picture will be here and all of these will be empty. It'll look like your account is empty or abandoned because you've got so many boards, so many great ideas, but then nothing is actually there. So when I wrote about 1 to 3 boards, then that determines how many pins per board. Recommendation is don't have so many boards that seem empty. And you can define how empty looks, but I believe when there's only 1 thing in a board, I think that looks too empty. 2 or 3, well, that looks like half full as well. So it's sort of like you need 5 or 6 things in one board to make it look complete, to make it look like you actually care and are using it. Well, then that means if I created 3 boards and I need 6 per each, I need 18 pins just so that my account doesn't look like, you know, half made. So perhaps 1 or 2 boards to get started. One board have it complete with 6 and the other board have 3. So that's still 8 pins even before you try to get followers, as we'll get to in a moment. So I think that's a downside on Pinterest, that whereas the other networks, I can get away with having 2 or 3 things on my Facebook before trying to get followers. But on Pinterest, it looks a little bit incomplete when I don't have enough content. Yeah.
So unlike Facebook, where your followers on, say, a community page or a public page can post on your site, they're not able to do that in Pinterest?
Yes.
If somebody bakes that cake and it's a big flop, they're not going to post a burnt-up cake there.
Exactly. The only way for someone to post onto it is if you've approved them as a collaborator.
Okay.
And you have to go to the very obvious step then of going here and putting their email.
Right.
So obviously, I'm not going to allow someone that's going to trash me. So Pinterest is very good at controlling your message. There's no way that anyone can post on your stuff and trash you.
Or the opposite.
In terms of you doing it to someone else?
No. If everybody's making terrific birthday cakes,
yes.
Way they can say, hey, I tried it, this is great.
Hey, I tried it, this is great.
Okay.
There is the tries. There's the opposite in terms of someone sees my cake, they can then click I tried it, then it'll show up that way, but not in the negative way of me going there and putting negative comments on the posts. The closest thing to that is the tries, which I'll further expound on in a moment. Yes?
Other than on your website, can you cross-promote on the different social media networks? So on Facebook, you could post the links to your Pinterest page.
You can. Some networks...
Could you post the link to Facebook and say, comment on these pages?
You can. Some of these networks are friendly and some are hostile to that, meaning that on some networks I am able to easily post it to the others. For example, on the share button right here, it looks like I can easily cross-promote here, that I can put this Pinterest stuff into Facebook or Twitter. The opposite, however, I don't have a button on Twitter or Facebook to do the opposite. Again, Facebook and Twitter are bigger, so they feel like we don't need to be friends. However, nothing stops you from me getting the link to something on Pinterest and copying it, and then going into the network manually. I don't see here Snapchat. So I can copy my link, I can go to Snapchat, I can paste it manually into Snapchat. Nothing stops that. But some networks are a little more friendly in that they give you this more obvious way to share, or more user-friendly way to share. All right, so one of the things early on that you want to do is make sure your account is set up here. You've got your graphics, your logos, you've got some boards, you've got some pins. We'll take a break, and then after we come back, we'll look at how to create a good pin. And then after that, we'll look also about how to try to get some followers and boosting and so forth. So it's 11:51. We'll be back at 12:01 or so, and then we'll go on.